This video is brought to you by Captivating History. On the 1st of September, 1939, Hitler invaded Eastern Poland. A couple of days later, France and England declared war on Germany. And a mere 15 days later, the Soviet Union made its way into Western Poland. The Soviets continued to work alongside the Germans for almost 2 years, when suddenly the Axis forces decided to launch an offensive against the Soviets. The glaring question here is, what brought about this abrupt change of heart? The most succinct answer to this question would be Finland. Today, we associate Finland with Scandinavia, the territory of neutral nations. But there is more to Finland than meets the eye. The Finns have struggled long and hard for the freedom they so thoroughly enjoy today. They have prevailed against countless acts of colonial oppression and laid many a scheme of suppression to rest. The preeminent example of their fortitude is their defiance of Soviet condescension. Finland's relationship with the Russians goes back to the early 1800s when it was part of Sweden. The Russian Tsar, Alexander I, had signed the Treaties of Tilsit with Napoleon and waged war against Sweden to protect St. Petersburg, later called Leningrad, but eventually renamed again. Finland was supposed to be a buffer state, but constant Russian interference soured their diplomatic relationship. The Bolshevik Revolution of 1917 transformed the political landscape of Russia. The Bolsheviks gave the right of self-determination to minorities and, having bided their time, the Finnish people decided to secede. But as to who would rule the newly sovereign state, no one had a clue. A civil war ensued in Finland between the conservative faction and the socialist faction. Despite Soviet backing, the champions of Red Finland lost. Since no formal treaty had taken place, volunteers from Finland conducted invasions in the Karelian region of the Soviets. Similarly, Finnish communists based in the USSR also tried their hand at sabotage. In 1920, Finland and the Soviet Union signed the Treaty of Tartu, settling their demarcations and political differences for the time being. With the East Karelian Uprising of 1921, Finland was able to annex Karelia, triggering retaliation by the Finnish communists in the USSR. As passions flared up on both sides, the two countries engaged in violence, only to later opt for peace talks. A non-aggression pact was signed, remaining intact for almost 17 years. Joseph Stalin assumed power in the Soviet Union in 1924. Revamping the Soviet Union's economic policies, Stalin set out on a mission of rapid industrialization, gaining political enemies by the hordes. He began ousting government and party officials, taking severe measures against reactionaries. The political turmoil intensified in 1938 when Stalin carried out the Great Purge, engaging in the statewide ethnic cleansing of minorities in an attempt to polarize the political hegemony and yield absolute power. One major issue with this approach was the weakening of the Soviet armed forces. Stalin purged a large number of marshals, generals, and high-level commanders. Afterward, the officers who assumed those ranks were far less competent, albeit very, very loyal. At the time, the Red Army was the largest in the world, and Stalin feared Hitler would break the pact, so he deployed most of his military in eastern Poland. He also deployed another large number of troops in the Far East to defend against the Japanese. In the same year, the Soviet Union had informed Finland that war with Germany was a definite possibility and asked them to lease some islands around Leningrad. Finland was committed to neutrality and assured the Soviets that any incursion would have harsh consequences. As countries picked sides in the Second World War, the Germans and Soviets signed the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, a treaty grouping Finland with the Soviet Union. The Soviets were ill-reputed under Stalin's regime, especially after the purges. Foreseeing the inevitable Soviet invasion, the Finns mobilized their troops near the Soviet border under the guise of refresher training. The Soviet troops were already at the Soviet-Finnish border, awaiting orders from above. Stalin demanded that Finland move their territory back so they could fortify Leningrad in time of war. There was an overwhelming suspicion that Germany would use Finland to advance its troops into Soviet territory, and Hitler also wanted Finland to lease several islands in the Gulf of Finland. In return, the USSR would cede eastern Karelia. The issue divided the Finnish government, which favored public opinion and rejected the Soviet offer, though they did make a couple of counteroffers that did not entice the USSR. In November of 1939, the Soviet village of Manila, located close to the Soviet-Finnish border, was attacked. Since there was no Finnish artillery units in or near the area, historians have concluded that the attack was a Russian ploy to renounce the peace treaty. The Soviet Minister of Foreign Affairs, Vyacheslav Molotov, held the Finnish government responsible and demanded an apology. After Finland denied the allegations, the Soviet Union severed diplomatic ties with Finland, and Stalin ordered his generals to prepare for an invasion of Finland. After the success of the Red Army in Poland, Stalin expected Finland to fall in a matter of weeks. The Soviet command was divided into two schools of thought. Stalin's favorite general in the armed forces, Marshal Grigory Kulik, guided one hand, while Generals Grigory Kravchenko and Georgi Zhukov guided the other. The latter had been part of the battles of Khalkhin Gol, where the Soviets had achieved a massive victory. The generals wanted a more stringent offensive because the terrain was not friendly and could cause problems for the Russian troops. They wanted to launch an artillery offensive to render Finnish defenses ineffectual. But the optimistic whims of the Soviet leadership prevailed, and an ineffective offensive was launched instead. When the Winter War began, there were almost 2 million soldiers in the Red Army. They deployed a little less than half of them in Finland. The Soviet Union had had the most basic training and could not deal with the rugged terrain. Moreover, the purges had eaten away at the army's discipline, and civilian involvement had left it with a fragmented chain of command. On the other hand, the Finns had deployed a little over 300,000 troops. Marshal Carl Gustav Mannerheim, a hero from the Finnish Civil War, led the Finnish armed forces as they hunkered down in the Karelian Isthmus. Finland held the Soviet minister, Vyacheslav Molotov, responsible for the war. When the Finns devised handheld bottle firebombs, they named them Molotov cocktails, since it was a drink to go with his food parcels. Despite being heavily outnumbered, the Finnish armed forces more than held their own, putting up an effective defense that kept the Soviets at bay for weeks. The Red Army's fresh recruits stuck out like sore thumbs in the snowy terrain. While the Soviets were making sense of the foreign landscape, the Finnish army conducted hit-and-run raids on isolated units. During this time, the Finnish sniper, Simo Haja, killed about 500 Soviets. Even though the Red Army was inexperienced, they were heavily armed and equipped with the leading technology of the time. As the conquest turned out to be more difficult than imagined, the Soviets regrouped, reorganized, brought in new personnel, and adjusted their tactics. Massive artillery units bombarded the Mannerheim line at the Karelian Isthmus and broke through. The Finns expected help from their Western allies, especially Sweden and Britain, but none arrived. The Soviets kept gaining ground, and outside interference seemed more redundant by the day. With their back against the wall, Finland finally sent a delegate to Moscow to negotiate an armistice. Unfortunately, the Soviets had the upper hand in the war, and they overwhelmed the Finns with frivolous demands. The Finns were taking heavy casualties at Karelia's Isthmus, and so they agreed to Soviet demands, giving up 11% of their territory to the opposition. The Moscow Treaty took place on the 12th of March 1940, putting an end to the Winter War. In the December of 1940, British Prime Minister Winston Churchill briefly discussed the idea of going to war with the Soviet Union. The vision did not materialize, but Churchill's remarks on the Soviet-Finnish War offered scathing criticism of the USSR and heaped praise on the courageous Finns. Misery acquaints a man with strange bedfellows. And so, a year later, Churchill and Stalin would join forces against Nazi Germany. But strange bedfellows or not, the Soviets did not decide to join the Allies. The Germans made that choice for them. After Hitler witnessed the incompetence of the Soviets in Finland, he became convinced that he could dismantle and conquer the USSR. The mistaken belief led Hitler to march into the Soviet Union with high hopes. On the 22nd of June 1941, he launched Operation Barbarossa and invaded the Soviet Union. The Soviets had had enough time on their hands to learn from their mistakes. When the Germans entered the Russian terrain, they were no match for the local army. They suffered heavy casualties at the hands of the Soviets, changing the course of the war. The Soviet-Finnish War may pale compared to other battles, but it weighed heavier on the outcome of the Second World War than most events. A far more thorough treatise is available if you'd like to learn more about the Winter War. Check out our book, The Winter War, a captivating guide to the Russo-Finnish War between Finland and the Soviet Union. It's available as an ebook, paperback, and audiobook. Also, grab your Mythology Bundle ebook for free while they're still available. All links are in the description. If you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button and subscribe for more videos like this.